Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Fabrice. I'm going to be talking about some of the research that we've been doing, just looking at including uncertainty in biodiversity layers in decision support tools. So this is some of the research that I've been doing in a project that's run by Carolyn Lundquist, which is looking at spatially explicit decision support tools. So lots of words there. So one of our decision support tools that we use is a software called Zonation. And this is a software that we use for systematic conservation planning, which is where we can incorporate spatial information, which is often biodiversity information, combine that with other uses. So an example of that might be, say, fishing. And we try and come up with areas which are good for conservation that satisfy both biodiversity and other values or stakeholder objectives. And so one of the issues that we find with, well, it's not really an issue actually, we tend to use habitat suitability or spatial predictions for our biodiversity layers. And so of course these are predictions from a model and they're not necessarily reality. And here's an example of a stony coral there that was produced as part of some work by Owen Anderson, where we have the red areas up here are areas that are predicted to be highly suitable for the growth of these corals, and the blue areas are areas where we predict it to be low suitability. And in a lot of cases, we don't actually incorporate the uncertainty of these models, but that's increasingly becoming a thing that is done. And so we can also get our uncertainty in our model predictions. And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to look at the effect of including these uncertainty layers into our systematic conservation and see whether that makes a difference to our results. And so the short answer is that it has a large effect on our results. So the plot on the left there is a map of the prioritization values from our trade-off model, where the areas in red are areas that we predict are the best for conservation planning, would be the best areas to put an MPA, and the areas in gray are the worst. And when we include uncertainty into the model through some discounting, we see that the pattern in those areas that are predicted to be the best for conservation change quite radically. And so those are the boxes there that are highlighted there. We see some areas that were predicted to be low suitability becoming very high, and vice versa. So if we drill a little bit deeper and we actually look at what's happening for the individual cells in the model, here we've got another example of a different stony coral. And this plot here shows the habitat suitability along with the associated uncertainty for that pixel. And what we're doing is we're comparing those cells for models where we included uncertainty and we didn't. Okay, so red areas represent an increase in cells in the model where we included uncertainty, and blue represents a decrease in those cells uptaken in the model with uncertainty. So it's a bit of a complex plot, but there's kind of four main points to take away from it. The first is that in both scenarios, cells which had high conservation value, okay, high habitat suitability, and also that had low uncertainty, were selected. And this is a good thing, right? We know that they're very good. Let's include them in our best solution. Conversely, areas with low habitat suitability and low uncertainty were taken up in the model when we didn't include uncertainty, but they were taken out when we included that uncertainty. So this is also a really good thing. We know those cells, or we have a good idea that those cells aren't particularly good, so we really shouldn't bother including them. And then there's a little bit of subtlety in the other two areas, which are this area here at the back. These are areas that are predicted to have high conservation value, but also they have high uncertainty. So in the models where we don't bother including the uncertainty, these drive the solution, okay? So they're considered very important. But as soon as we include the uncertainty, well, basically what we're saying is we're not 100% sure that these are good areas. So we should maybe discount those areas and not include them in the final solution. So that's really important. That's proving that including these in our trade-off models is actually probably very important. And then finally, we have these areas which are predicted to have low habitat suitability, but which are also really uncertain. And when we include these in the model, where we have uncertainty in the trade-off model, there's actually an increase in the number of those cells in the solution, because actually they can provide what's called positive surprises, in the sense that we think that they're not very good, but we're not very sure, so they might actually be really good. And so this basically just kind of shows how important it is to both create uncertainty predictions from our biodiversity maps, but also that those uncertainty layers can now be included in our trade-off models, which are kind of best practice now moving forward for systematic conservation planning. So I'd just like to thank the team members, Sustainable Seas, for the funding, as well as the aligned funding. Thank you.